Well, as we get ready to worship, it's Chester's birthday today, and I want to be sure that I say just a couple words to you before he leads us. I've never had anyone that has been more faithful to stay the course, be committed to what God's doing, than Chester. He's been right there with me. When I think about those who have long-term faithfulness between Chester and Eddie and a few others, they've been with me for the whole journey. They fit in the same category as Pat Welch as far as the journey of time. And so I thank the Lord for Chester and his birthday today. And I know he's chasing after 60, so be in prayer for him as he heads that way. All right? Just that he's not there yet, but you can tell by the color of his hair that he's getting close. So let's worship. We've got Chester lead us in worship, and happy birthday to you, my brother.
That one. Let's sing, Lord, I lift your name on high. From heaven to earth to show the way from
righteousness be restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are a voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call.
This morning to have Miss Tricia Kennedy come. She's going to sing a song called He's Always Been Faithful. Tricia.
Thanks, Chester. Lamentations 3:22 through 24 reminds us the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him.
a beautiful song that reminds us of God's faithfulness. And I want you to think about it for a moment. This week we experienced the obviously sad loss of Pat Welch. And I wanted to put on the screens two pictures of her so that you'd be able to see her if you don't know her by name. She was a jovial joy who lit up any room she was in and displayed faithfulness in a way that coincides so clearly with the faithfulness of God at work in each one of our lives. And when I think about how powerful and how special Pat was, and as far as living out day by day, I think about the treasure that God gives us in relationships. And I want you to think about for a moment that God puts people in our lives for a reason. And they're there to encourage and equip and help us and bless us. And I met Pat on the very first week we moved to Atlanta, Georgia. And from that first moment to all almost 25 years later, she displayed faithfulness and commitment to her pastor as well as to her church. And when we started One Heart Church over 15 years ago, she was one of the first people that was there, along with Sybil and Inger and a few others who said, you know what, this is going to be our home forever. And so I wanted to take a moment and I wanted to contrast with the sadness of her loss, the preciousness of her gain. Because I want you as a church family to realize something. I had prayed when COVID started way back in March that none of our church family had to walk through this valley. But now today we find many who are having to battle the virus and contend with different issues related to it. And Pat battled the virus, had overcome a lot of the virus except for the one aspect that we all need, and that's for our lungs to work properly. And that is really what caused the difficulty and heartache that she endured in the very last moments of her life in the last few weeks. And so I thank the Lord for her. I just wanted to say to all of our church family that every person is precious. And what's most precious is when we trust Jesus, we know that when we leave this earth, we have the privilege of being able to see Jesus face to face. I'm also thankful that her son has a faith in Christ and believes, and she loved her son dearly, had a great love for him, lost a daughter early in life, and so those children were the treasures that she held on to. And so I wanted to just remind all of you, be vigilant when it comes to making sure you wash your hands and wear your mask and distance, because we are still in the throes of a great battle. That's the very reason that we are online only today and next Sunday, because we realized when we started getting reports, this member, this member, this member, this member, we realized that we wouldn't want anyone to catch the virus. Betty did not catch it here at the church. Cassie perhaps did, but not in the worship experience. It was in another area in our office. And so we don't know. You know, you never know. This virus is not visible, so you don't know who's carrying it around. And 2/3 of people who are carrying it are asymptomatic and feel nothing regarding the virus. And so I just wanted to say to our church family, thank you for your willingness to to adapt at a very quick fashion. And I also want to say to you, for those of you who did not get the email the first time, we had all kinds of technological challenges. We had for the last 2 hours technological challenges here in this room just to be able to come into your home. And so we're praying we're able to do this uninterrupted and be an encouragement to you. So I just wanted to take a moment, thank God for Pat. Thank God she's seen Jesus face to face. Thank God she's seen her parents. Thank God that she's encountered the one who knew her name. And the truth of the matter is, for the same lady who baked a lot of cookies for us, she is experiencing a sweetness now that is not even comparable to all that she baked and all that she fixed. She is, in fact, dining in the presence of Jesus. What a great, great experience for her. Let's pray together and ask the Lord to bless as we thank the Lord for her. Father, thank you for Pat. Thank you for what she has meant to all of us. She represented the very heart of who we are. She stood at the center doors of our church over the last number of years, greeting people, hugging people, smiling at people. And while she didn't have the privilege to walk back in here again, from March until her walking into eternity, she did walk in to a place where there's no weeping, no sorrow, no tears. And so for her son, I pray your blessings on him. I pray you'd watch over him. I pray that you would anoint the days that are ahead of him, that you would give him the job that he needs and meet the needs that he has. And so, Lord, I just thank you for her life. Thank you for the privilege we have as a church family to weep with those who weep, to have sorrow when we lose someone we love, but then also rejoice to be precious in the sight of the Lord is the homegoing of God's children. Lord, thank you for that promise in the Old Testament that sustains us now as we live out our call in life for you. Bless us, Lord, as we continue to worship. In Christ's name, amen.
Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. I have a living hope.
I have a living hope.
I have a future.
I have a future.
God has a plan for me.
God has a plan for me.
Of this I'm sure. Of this I'm sure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. Your word is faithful.
Your word is faithful.
Mighty in power. God has delivered me. Of this I'm sure. Of this I'm sure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word.
Let's sing this great hymn of the faith together.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Satisfy my soul like you, and who on earth could comfort me and love me like you do? Who could ever be more faithful and true? I will trust in you. I will trust in you, my God. Living water rain down your life on me, cleansing me, refreshing me with life abundantly. River full of life, I'll go where you lead. I will trust in you. I will trust in you, my God. There is a fountain. Who is the King? Victorious warrior and Lord of everything. My rock, my shelter.
Just in time, capturing the moments that matter the most in life. This week I had one of those Kairos moments, and as related to Pat Welch, I found myself one early morning in the middle of scripture and focusing in on what it was that God was saying to me, and I can remember so vividly that the Lord impressed on me to share a concept that I believe could be encouraging and helpful and meaningful to Pat at a critical moment. And it was interesting because I was balancing two thoughts. One was just how easy it is to be frustrated and to be overwhelmed and discouraged, and how important it is to be focused and faithful. And so today, as we dive into our message in Ephesians chapter 5, I want to encourage you to think about in your own life. Think about the last week. How many moments did you have where you were frustrated, discouraged, overwhelmed? And how many moments did you have where you found yourself in a place where you were focused, with laser focused, you were fruitful? And in that moment of sharing, I sent it to her son, Doug, to share with her as she was recovering, and he wrote me back and he said, I think I see tears in her eyes. And it reminded her to stay faithful in the midst of what it is she's going through in life. And so today, we look at what could not be a more important message in this series on choices that define us. And if you recall, last week I asked you to memorize Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. And I hope in a moment you'll be able to, in your mind and heart, in your home, be able to share that verse with others who are in your house right now. But here's the question you have for the day. And that is, do you understand the challenges of our day? Do you understand the things that we must contend with? And if you look at the events of the last few days, you realize that there are lots of challenges. But the question becomes more amplified when you think through, will you personally accept the challenge? In other words, will you say, you know what, I'm going to accept this challenge to be who God intends for me to be? And it comes down to us having the capacity to make right choices, to make right choices. And so as you're watching at home, and a few who are here in the worship room, you start thinking through regarding the choices you've made in life, and you realize something, that when you get to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 and 16, you say, remember the verse, think about it for a second. It says, therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of the time, for the days are evil. So to be careful and capturing the moments God has for you. And remember we said last week that when you define kairos, one of the ways to define it was a right, critical, opportune moment. But I wanted to add another definition to it so you would even get more and more understanding, because you're going to see today as we look at what's happening in Ephesians in chapter 5 as well as chapter 1 and chapter 6, three times Paul uses this word, and his intention and his emphasis is for us to understand that we all have kairos moments. We have these moments where God puts before us this very measured, allocated, fixed season of time. All right? And so if you'll think about it for a moment, God has these moments. And by the way, they don't come by twice. They come as we submit ourselves to Him and we allow Him to work in our life. And that's why when you get to chapter 5, it's so absolutely powerful. Now, I want you to think about with me for a moment. Think through with me. If you look back to chapter 1 and verse 9, notice you would, just for a second, I want to show you something, because I want to show you what happens when Paul is trying to say to the church at Ephesus, which, by the way, Ephesus was a place where there was so much going on, there were so many different aspects transpiring, and what I want you to see today is this, that as we arrive at places where we see we have kairos moment, there are things that God wants to do inside of each one of us, something begins to change in how we look at life, because here's what you discover. Every day is precious, every day is meaningful, every day has substance, and you just have to be willing to grab that day and grab those moments that God gives you. So look, if you would, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9. He made known to us the mystery of His will according to His kind intention, which He purposed in Him with a view to an administration suitable to the fullness of the times. Kairos. That is the summing up of all things in Christ, things in the heavens and things on the earth. In Him also we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to His purpose, who works all things after the counsel of His will, to the end that we who are first to hope in Christ would be the praise of His glory. All right, so he says here that what Paul tries to say to the church at Ephesus is it. The whole story fits together, and it fits together this way. Jesus, who introduces Himself into our hearts and lives, He becomes our Savior. As a result of Him being our Savior, we have the privilege of being able to experience Him. Now, in chapter 5 and verse 16, you'll notice they're making the most of the time, all right, because the days are evil. And we live in unique and evil days in lots of different ways, and you look at the world we're in, it is a unique challenge to live as light and to walk in love and to bear out the wisdom God gives us. But you're going to see today that our lives are built around a triangle of focus. This is exactly what was transpiring inside of Paul's mind as he wrote these verses, because here's what he knew, that if we could understand His love and we could grasp what the light is all about and live as light, then we would walk in wisdom. And so today, as you think about it in your own life, think through for a moment. Do you find yourself feeling loved by God? Do you find yourself walking in the light? Do you find yourself facing life with wisdom in choices that you make? Because here, listen, these choices that we make in life define us. How we approach things, how we move through things, how we find ourselves moving forward. So I want you to think about that. Now, I wanted to mention one other verse. In chapter 6 and verse 18, Paul says this, that we pray with all prayer and petitions. With all prayer and petitions, we bring ourselves, in fact, to pray at all times in the Spirit. Okay? All right? So now think about this in light of what transpired. So all of a sudden, you get in your mind that there's something going on that you need not miss. And that is that you have experienced His hope. And as a result of that, you get to experience the inheritance you have in Him. Which, by the way, you're going to see Him come back to inheritance again, because here's what you discover. If you are in Christ, you have something coming for your life that you could never imagine. All right? But when you walk out, when you walk outside of Christ, you lose that inheritance. There's no way you could have an inheritance that is going to come from disobedience. And what he uses certain terminology to explain what happens when a person chooses not to walk in love. Because when they don't walk in love, they're walking in disobedience. All right. So I want you to see this. And so as you think through this, I want you to think about, so he says that we have an inheritance. Then he says that we have to be careful how we walk because the days are evil. Then he says we pray and our petitions are always praying in the Spirit. And you'll notice he goes on to say, with all perseverance. So, as you imagine for a second, I just want to show you three very distinctive things, all right? I want the triangle to be built into your mind and heart, because during these weeks, we are going to learn what it means to experience Kairos moments, those right critical opportunities placed before us by God, measured, allocated, fixed by Him in order to experience what He intends. So the first thing I want you to see is what it means to walk in love. Look if you would. And by the way, if you look at the word walk, and you may even have this in NIV translation, it'll say live. All right. So walking, living, what he's trying to say is that there's a parallel between those two. And whether you're walking or whether you are living, it is the same thing. All right. So look at me beginning in verse 1. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering, a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. Now watch what he does here. But immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you as is proper among saints. And there must be no filthiness, silly talk, coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving thanks. For this you know with certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance, there's your word inheritance again, you might circle and go back and realize chapter 1, in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. Don't do it. Don't be partakers. Do not be partakers with those who choose to talk wrong, who choose to express themselves a certain way, or choose to live wrong. All right? So let's think about this. Because what he wants us to do, there are three things he wants us to do in order to walk in love. First of all, to arrive at an understanding of his love and sacrifice. And you see that in verses 1 and 2. He says, be imitators of God, his beloved children, walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. This year at Christmas time, my wife discovered these little stemmed green things that were infused with an aroma that was absolutely Christmas, and it was absolutely beautiful and wonderful. And it gave a fresh smell to every place. And you could hang them on your Christmas tree. You wouldn't see them because they were green. They were in different places. I had them in my office. And every one of those places, you could smell the aroma that had been produced by those little green pieces of material. Now, here's what I want you to see. When you understand what Jesus has done for you, nothing could smell better, nothing could be more powerful. The second thing you have to realize, though, is he says here there are certain things that you should not, look at verse 3. He said, but immorality, impurity, greed must not even be named among you as is proper among the saints. What does he say? How do you defeat all these? How do you get rid of these? How do you deal with it? You defeat challenges with gratitude. Now notice what he says here. But rather, verse 4, latter part, but rather giving of thanks. So here's what he's saying. You get caught up in something that's not going to get you where God wants you to go, and as a result, you struggle to understand that what it is that's going on inside of you, and then all of a sudden you stop and you thank the Lord for what it is he has for you. Today, think about it for a moment. Think about how thankful we should be that we have life, that we are sustained by him, that we are equipped by him, we're motivated by him. I want to ask you, this week, how many times did you say, Lord, thank you for this, thank you for that? I'm walking through a new journal this year, and one of the things that the journal does is it requires you every day to write down three things you are thankful for. At least three things, which, by the way, that should be the minimum for any person, to be able to thankful for your health, thankful for your joy, thankful for your peace, thankful for the different things that God gives you. And what he says here is, you want to overcome all these things? Get thankful. Because what does gratitude do? It shifts your focus away from yourself towards God. All right? So first of all, be careful to arrive at understanding his love, his sacrifice, that sweet aroma that comes from that. Be sure to defeat challenges with gratitude. But then look on. One other thing I want you to see, because you'll notice he says very clearly to us, beginning in verse 5, for this you know that with certainty, that no immoral, impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of God. But let no one deceive you, watch this, with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. All right, here is a principle that is so essential for you and me when it comes to living out the Kairos moments of our lives. Evaluate carefully what you choose to hear. Be careful what you listen to. Evaluate carefully what you choose, because you could be listening to something that will lead you away from God's best for your life. All right? That's why you see a confidence crisis in our entire land, because people choose to listen to some they shouldn't listen to and vice versa. And as a result, they end up being able to be misled in certain directions. And what happens here is that Paul makes it clear, let no one deceive you with empty words. In other words, words that don't have substance, don't have meaning, don't have purpose, are not going to allow you to walk in love. They're going to cause you to miss the love that God has for you. So in that triangle, the top part of that triangle is God's love, all right? Because God so loved us that the love of God is what consumes our very being, all right? The next part of that triangle is that we have to bear the light, all right? Look at verse 8 and notice with me if you would. Verse 8. Notice what he says here. For you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead even expose them. For it is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light, for everything that becomes visible is light. For this reason it says, awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. So what does he say here? He says that it's absolutely essential for us to bear the light. All right? In other words, we are, and you'll notice he makes it very personal by saying, you are, in verse 8, but now you are light in the Lord. And we know from Matthew 5:14 and John 8:12 that Jesus is the light of the world. All right? And so what we understand about this particular text is that what he's trying to do is help us understand something, that if we are going to live, in fact, I read a quote that actually helps us understand how to live this out in a vibrant, dynamic way. Listen to what this quote said. If you want to shine in the night, keep me in the light. If you want to shine in the night, keep me in the light. So think about this. When do most people do a lot of bad things? In the night. In the night. And they make choices that lead them toward doing the wrong thing. In the night. In the night. So what does he say? Keep me in the light so that I can shine. If you want me to shine in the night, keep me in the light as I live out my life. Today I want to ask you to think about for a second. Are you allowing the light to shine inside of you? Because it's interesting what he does here. He contrasts the very positive and the very negative, all right? The first thing he says is we ought to all take a test. Look at it with me if you would. He says it very clearly here. In verse 8, he says, you formerly walked in darkness, but now you're light. Walk as children of the light. Live, in other words, as children of the light. And for the fruit of the light consists of goodness, righteousness, and truth. All right? So let's think about those three concepts there, because they're a great test for us. Because what is goodness connected to? It's connected to generosity, because God is good. He blesses us in all ways. And so we understand that goodness connects us to being generous. And then you talk about righteousness, being right with God, and it has to do with the whole idea of integrity in our lives, us being having integrity. And then you'll notice he talks about truth, which is the absence of deception, which is what he's about to deal with in more detail. So when we look at these, we also understand this, that for each one of them, for goodness, another way to look at it is love in action. Love in action. For righteousness, it's to understand you be right in character, which is what integrity is all about, to be right in character. And truth is God's word at work inside of each one of our lives, all right? So here's what you got to do. You got to stop for a minute and take the test. Am I living in his goodness? Am I living righteously? Am I walking in the truth? Because watch this. If I'm experiencing his goodness and I understand how to live righteously and the truth is a part of who I am, what's going to happen? I'm going to bear the light to anyone who is looking for it. And there couldn't be a more important day with a choice that can define us than us to choose to live out bearing the light to those who are walking in darkness. All right? So, and by the way, if we don't bear that light, what happens to us? We stain ourselves. We stain ourselves. Now watch what he does. Notice what he does here. Look at verse 11. Do not participate. In other words, don't do any of these things in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead even expose them. For it is disgraceful even to speak of things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light, for everything that comes visible is light. What do we do here? We understand something, that what is most essential for you and me is to avoid what stains our witness. What is it that could get in the way and stain our witness and cause us difficulty? I'm at the stage of life where sometimes I drop things on my sweater, I drop things on my clothes. This particular sweater was stained. It was stained. I had to take it into the cleaners and they had to work on it. And it's always interesting when you take in something like this, they'll always ask you, what is that? All right? And so my very first thought is, well, surely you realize it's food, because you can look at me and realize that if I'm going to stain anything, it's going to be food that stains it. And then they'll say, well, did it have tomato paste and all these different things? Here's what I want you to realize. The person who's gifted to take the stain out, you can't see the stain now because it's gone. All right? Here's what Paul's saying. Don't let any stains hit your heart. Don't any stains mess up your light. Don't cause your light to flicker, because if you do, you'll end up living out some very unwise choices. And just this weekend, I was listening to some music, and I listened to a new artist that had been introduced. And so I thought, I'm going to read that person's background. And it's interesting, because it's in every person's life, there are little moments where they'd like to regret and be done with. The choices they made that were not the best choices, not the wisest choices, unwise choices that stained their witness for a moment. And this particular person had one of those experiences in a year's time. And it's interesting what she said. She said, in that year, I did not sing a single note of music because I had stained the very music that I was singing. I'd stained the witness. And so today, think about it for a moment. That triangle, you understand what his love can do, and you walk in it. You bear the light that is the light of Jesus, and it changes who you are. In fact, you remember, if you want to shine in the night, keep me in the light. The third thing you see comes down to the verse 15 and through 17, which is really the heartbeat of where we're going to stop today, because here's what I want you to see. When you get to this place, he says, walk as wise, not unwise men. not as foolish people. And here's what I want you to see. In life, we all have the opportunity to choose the path that God places before us. And we'll choose that path either the wise way or the unwise way. We'll either go God's way or some other way. And I want you to imagine what it would be like today if all of us chose the right path. You'll notice what he says here. Verse 15, therefore be careful how you walk. And I think about it this way. Look before you leap. Be careful. And just this last year, I had an experience like I've never had in my lifetime. I've talked about it at church before, but I just want to illustrate with it in a particular way because of what transpired. I took a fall this last year, and the most vivid part of the entire experience was my granddaughter Nora Grace was with me, and I was paying no attention to where I was going. She was paying all attention because she is wonderfully into detail. So she can see steps, she can see different things. And so I'm walking along, and I can remember, this is what I remember before I fell on my face, all right, and ruined my wonderful glasses and other thing. I can remember hearing my granddaughter's voice that said, "Watch where you're stepping, Gaga." And you know what I did? I ignored that completely and landed on my face. And it was such a painful thing. I was bleeding, and that same granddaughter ran to get her mother and her grandmother to come. But you know what could have stopped all that? If I had stopped and been careful because she was cautioning me. Listen, God cautions us. Notice what he says here. Be careful how you walk. And the word, by the way, careful here, has two distinctive meanings to it. To be precise, and to be accurate, all right? Which means you take every step. For example, when I walk down these steps, if you ever watch me walking down the steps of this pulpit, I do it for a reason. I know if I miss a step, you're going to watch me fly. You're going to watch me fall. And listen, you know why I have that lesson? Why I still look before I leap, before I take a fly? Is because when I was 22 years old, I was in a church in Dell City, Oklahoma. The orchestra was all right here, and they all had these amazing instruments that they all played and stuff, and they played at the end of the service, they play a finale. It was beautiful. It was a fantastic church. And so I made the announcements, and I can remember it just like this, because I was up there, and I'm 22, and I'm talking about all the things, the great things God's doing. It's going to be amazing. And then I walk out like this, and right here, they had a little piece of rubber that was there to keep, that was there for the pastor to know that if he gets that close, he's stepping near the edge of the step. Well, the back of my heel caught that, and I went flying. I wiped out two sections of the orchestra all at one time. And Cindy can still remember it. I can still remember it. And it's because I wasn't careful. Today, listen, don't wipe out two sections of your life by not being careful. Be wise, all right? Look on. He says, you'll notice what he says here. Making the most of your time. What's he saying here? Look around as you live and maximize those moments. Listen, take them in. Let them be the best for you. If you are friends with Pat on Facebook, you read what Doug wrote as a summation of his entire experience of losing his mom. It's a beautiful thing because here's what he said. Maximize every moment that you have. Every moment. That's why when FaceTime comes on and one of our grandchildren calls in, we always talk to them. That's why when we have the opportunity to encourage someone, we do that. And I have friends that live all over the world. And one of the things I try to do is maximize any moment I have in encouraging them, being a blessing to them. And today, as you think about that, what would it be like that if all of a sudden you were able to look around at how you're living and maximize it? Then you'll notice what he says, making the most of the time because the days are evil. And here's what I want you to grab hold of and understand. Acknowledge the times that we're in. It would be foolish for us to misunderstand that these are challenging, trying times. Things transpiring issues occurring that demand one thing of us, and that is to acknowledge the times with wisdom. Acknowledge the times with wisdom and to live as light. So think about that triangle for a moment as we wrap this all together. What happens if you learn how to walk in love and bear the light and choose the right path of wisdom? What happens is you become effective. And the choices you make don't have to be complicated. They can be as simple as you just saying, Lord, show me the way and I'll walk in it. Well, your choices you make, the simple question is this. What choices will you make that will affect your life this week? You know, we had to make some choices from technology and other things, and how I thank God for our team that is so dedicated to making sure that we're able to communicate into your home. And today, you're going to make a choice how to apply this message. You're going to figure out if your triangle is broken, if one piece is gone, if you haven't walked in love, you haven't borne the light, if you have not made a choice to walk in wisdom. And my encouragement today is simply this. Let the Lord watch over and guide you. Let him bless you. And I guarantee you, he'll make an eternal difference. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. Speaks to our lives. Lord, we thank you for the promises of Kairos moments in our lives. All of us will have some of those this week. I pray that more people have watched this broadcast online than any time since we started all the way back to March. I thank you, Lord, for gifted people that help us make it happen. And there's so many not to even call all their names. It'd be impossible. But I thank you for each one of them. And you know their name. And Lord, they've chosen to walk in love and bear a light. And they've chosen to get on the right path and choose the path that leads them towards you. Lord, as we wrap this message together, we pray your blessings on all of our church family. We pray your protection on everyone who is contending with this virus. We pray that you would watch over every person, that they would be wise and safe. The places they go, the things they do. Lord, this is the day to be wise. And Lord, we anticipate you doing something that only you can do, and that is to lead us towards victory in every day of our lives. We love you, and we commit this to you. Lord, let us shine even in the night, because the light of God is shining down on us. You are the light of the world. We bless you. We praise you. We thank you. May none of the deeds of darkness ever be attached to our name. May we instead be connected to the beautiful light that is the light of the world, that is Jesus. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing one more song as we go, and I'm going to ask you to do me a big favor, and that is, because we are not on site, I want to encourage you to mail your offering in. You can use the envelopes. Our theme this year is willing and able. We are willing. He is able to bless. And so if you haven't already done so, do so for last week or this week or the coming week. Be faithful in your stewardship. You can also go online at oneheartchurch.org and hit give, and you can give your offering. We just need to make sure we don't get behind as we start the new year. We want to be faithful stewards of what it is God's entrusted to us. God has great things in store for our church. And let me tell you why. I know some Kairos moments are coming for One Heart in 2021. Let's sing to crown him the King of Kings.
Sunday.